So good morning, Harvest.
How
come on,
y'all
guys,
doing?
Let's go stand together. Yeah, let's put our hands together.
Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Andy Rozier, and I serve on staff as the lead worship pastor, and I am so glad that you joined us today. Hey, we would love to know where you are watching from, so let us know in the chat or the comments. If this is your first time with us, I'm so glad that you chose to join us at Harvest today. Whether you're new or you come every week, we want to invite you to check in. You can do that on this page through a link in the comments on YouTube and Facebook or on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We would love to know that you're here, but more importantly, we want to know how we can pray for you this week. We count it a privilege and a joy to come alongside you and pray with you about the things that are going on in your life and in your heart. If you're not a guest, we want to help you faithfully worship the Lord, not just through singing, trust me, but through giving as well. Here are the ways that you can give. You can give online on this page. You can also hold your camera up to the QR code on the screen, and it will take you directly to the giving page on the Harvest website. you can give through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, through a text, or by mailing your gift to the Rolling Meadows campus. In the New Testament church, God gave us two ordinances. One is communion and the other is baptism. And today we get to witness baptisms and hear the testimonies of those who put their faith and trust in Jesus alone for salvation and the forgiveness of their sins. And hey, let me just say, if you're watching and you really do want to get baptized, please do reach out to your local campus pastor and we'll figure it out with you. Continuing our series through the book of Ephesians, Dr. Michael Rydelnik returns to finish Ephesians chapter 2 this week. And if you're willing and ready to return to church in person next Sunday, we would love to see you, and our campus pastors will take the baton of Ephesians and preach live on every campus. It's always great to hear from those guys. We thank God for his provision of Camp Harvest. It's a place where God changes lives, and we're asking him to do that again this summer. So registration is now open for summer camp for students, junior high and high school. I'll be taking both of my boys up there. Get the dates and details at harvestnow.info. Men, this announcement is for you. In Jude, verse 24 and 25, it says this, listen, now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, dominion, majesty, and authority before all time, now and forever. Amen. What a verse. What a life verse. Well, Saturday, men, June 5th, we are inviting all the men of our church to a one-day event that we're calling Now to Him. Together, we get to worship the one who is able to keep us from stumbling. We will hear from God's word. There will be tons of games and fun and some friendly competition as well. And there will be a massive amount of bacon. I should have just started the announcement with that word. Bacon. Saturday, June 5th. Guys, let's go. Yes, there will be a bacon fest. And it all starts at 1 o'clock at the Elgin campus. Registration is open now. I want to encourage you to sign up today. It's going to be a day that you will not want to miss. Bring your small group. Bring some guys from out of town. Let's make it happen. Go to harvestnow.info for all the details. Now, before I pray, let me just quickly invite you to stay online at the end of the service because we have one amazing special announcement. Let's pray. Father, we commit this time to you, our effort, our affection, our attention. And God, we ascribe worth to you in this moment through giving, through singing, through listening. We open up our hearts, Lord, to receive your word that we might not sin against you. Meet us, see us where we are right now. And Lord, receive our offering of worship to you. Send us out into the week ahead. And Lord, may you bless this time that we are gathered as you see wherever we are, Lord, but gathering under one name today. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
You ready, Kyle? Let's do it.
Born to the darkness I was, rejected and cut off from hope. I couldn't see his love for me. They said he's not who he seems. Don't get your hopes up for him. Lies fell away when I saw his face. My heart burst to life. I saw delight in his eyes when he looked at me. Now my whole world's on fire, alive in the presence that burns inside of me. Now I know whose I am. Forever I'll stand on your truth. Lord, I believe, 'cause I was
Hey, church, we're going to watch a baptism together of someone in our church. Yeah, feel free to go ahead and take a seat. Let's go ahead and watch this, and let's celebrate with them. Come on.
Hey, Harvest, my name is Ramirez Moody, and John and I are being joined today by our friend Steve Robleski. And Steve, why don't you share with us how life was for you before you surrendered your life to Christ?
Sure. I was... born and raised in the Catholic Church, and felt that I was blessed to recognize and come to know the Lord at an early age. I participated as an altar boy, went through catechism and confirmation. And then I just started getting a yearning for learning more about Christ and wanting to know more. And in the middle to late 70s, the Pentecostal movement was moving, and I was interested in it, and I met a man on a beach in Florida and started asking him about it, and he basically told me the gospel and asked if I believed. And at 16 years old, I accepted Christ, and that's when I felt that I was saved.
Amen. That's awesome. So you, on the beach that day, you professed your faith in Jesus Christ and Him alone.
Yes, I did.
That's awesome. So what's life been like since then?
Well, 40-something years later, 50 years later, I've walked down many wide roads that seem to be wide in the beginning, but always felt God there with me, walking with me, good times and bad. But then as I got older, I realized that as God was walking with me, those roads started to narrow. And it was at that time that Jesus, instead of being there with me, went ahead of me. And at that point is when I knew that I had to follow Jesus. Amen. And not just walk with him.
That's Amen. Awesome. That's
wow.
so great.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, Steve, why would you like to be baptized today?
Oh, to profess to everybody that Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. And I'll be a bold and spokesman for him. And I just want everyone to know.
All right.
Amen.
Well, Steve, it is by your profession of faith in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen, amen. Come on, let's go ahead and stand as we respond. The joy that salvation brings, right?
Yeah.
It's just awesome. Sick.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name. Into the night.
Come on, testify and sing.
And through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living. So great a mercy, what heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Lift it up. Salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise.
Come on, Kim.
Your very body began to breathe.
Out of the silence, the
begin to breathe out of the
God, with all we have, with all that we can bring, God, with our stories of your faithfulness, with the stories that are still being written of your faithfulness, where maybe we're in the waiting, we say, Christ, be glorified. For all the joy that we bring, because every good and perfect gift comes from you, we say, Christ, be glorified. And in any pain that we bring, Lord, we know that you work out all things for the good of those who love you.
Yes, you do.
So we sing, Christ, be glorified.
Be glorified.
God, because we know that you take what the enemy means for evil and you use it for good.
Yes, you do.
For our good and for your good. Because of that, we say,
Christ be glorified
in the heavens, yeah.
Christ be glorified.
You deserve it, you deserve it.
Christ be glorified.
You are King of Kings.
Christ be glorified.
Be glorified.
Lord. It's in the name of Christ that we pray. Amen. Amen, church. Amen.
Come on, let's glorify the King of Kings. Keep those hands together and just give God the best praise you got. Yes, God.
Come on, Kim, say that again. Yeah. Seriously.
In the heavens, Christ be glorified. Here on earth, Christ be glorified. Do I have a witness in the room?
Christ,
do I have a witness in the room? Anybody knows that Christ,
Christ
always, always
glorified.
Well, hey, we're going to open up God's word together. Let's go ahead and take a seat as we continue.
Could be bad, you know. Never applaud in advance. It's like getting paid in advance. Come on, you know better. Yeah, that's it. It's great to see you, and I want to greet everyone that I don't even see at our other campuses. It's wonderful to be with you, glorifying our Lord together. Wasn't that wonderful? Yeah. I'll tell you, the worst part of speaking at Harvest Bible Chapel, do you know what it is? They have this big screen, and all I can do is see myself here. I just want to put a black X over there. I'll look at you folks. That's what I'll do. Anyway, it's good to be with you. I'm so glad to be with you once again. I do want to tell you, I was very excited last week. I don't know if it happened here, but at Elgin, after we sang, I invited people to trust the Lord, and we saw a number of people make a decision. I was so excited, and I even got to speak with some people afterwards, and it was just so exciting to see new family, new people in the family of God. And I just want to thank God for that. That was one of the best things. Well, since last summer, with the murder of George Floyd, our whole country has been embroiled in racial tensions. And it has brought to the forefront the concerns of many that as a country, we still have not completely overcome our history of slavery, our history of Jim Crow, despite, I believe, the many strides of the civil rights movement. There's still tension between ethnic groups, and the fact that these exist, it's not a new problem. It's existed for eons. Tensions between peoples. And I want to say today, it is a long-standing problem, but not a problem without a resolution, without a cure. And that's what I want to talk about today. Today we're continuing our study in Ephesians, and the passage we're going to look at describes how the Lord Jesus overcame the alienation of Jewish people and the nations, the Gentiles, and made peace between the two groups. And that's what the passage is about. But that was the greatest conflict between peoples of that world in the first century. And so I believe it becomes a paradigm. The point that is made in this passage about the reconciliation between Jew and Gentile is not limited to Jews and Gentiles alone. It applies to every people group. It applies to black and white, Latino and Asian, Indian and Pakistani, Israeli and Palestinian, even rich and poor, city and suburban, male and female. All the divisions that we have can certainly be overcome. They can be resolved. What we have to do is look at God's word. God's work through our Messiah Jesus is central to overcoming the differences that are in the body of Jesus the Messiah, the ecclesia, the church. And so what I'd like you to do is we're gonna do a deep dive today in Ephesians 2, 11 through 22. Get out your Bibles. And I've even asked for the lights to be brought up so that you can actually see what's in your Bible, because we're going to actually look at what the Bible has to say about this. Let's see if we can remember what Ephesians is about. It's about examining, celebrating, looking at, checking out our eternal portfolio, living in light of our eternal portfolio. That's what the book of Ephesians is about. And it's got three big sections. The first three chapters are wealth, the wealth we have, our spiritual wealth. The second, our walk, how we live in light of that wealth. And then the third section is Ephesians 6, our warfare. So chapters 1 through 3, our wealth. Chapters 4 and 5, our walk. Chapter 6, our warfare. Got that? Okay. Now, my wife said I can't do this without a chart, so I'm doing it. I'm a living chart. Three chapters, two chapters, one chapter. Wealth, walk, warfare. I feel like I'm doing walk through the Bible. Now, the first three chapters deal with our wealth. The first chapter was the riches of redemption. And then 2, 1 through 10 that we discussed last week, the riches of regeneration. The Lord Jesus made us alive by his grace. And today, we're going to talk in Ephesians 2, 11 through 22 about the riches of reconciliation. That's what we're up to, okay? So it fits, it's flow of thought, that's part of our wealth, reconciliation. Now, it starts in verses 11 and 12 with the problem, which is alienation. Alienation between people groups. Alienation between Jew and Gentile in this text, but it really is dealing with the alienation that we all have. But I want you to look real carefully at Ephesians 2, 11 and 12. It starts with the problem of alienation. He talks about the Jewish attitude of condescension against Gentiles. Look at verse 11. Therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in flesh by hands. Circumcision refers to the outward sign of the Abrahamic covenant. And they would look down, sort of condescend. The pagans, Gentiles, they're the uncircumcised. Now, I want to be really clear about this. I understand it, because it goes back to the Bible. What it means is, remember, by the way, when I say it goes back to the Bible, do you remember what David said when he shows up at the battle with Goliath? And he says, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should taunt the armies of the living God? To call someone uncircumcised is to say they have no standing. They've got no covenant. They've got no promises. They've got nothing. But I think the problem here was a little bit of but we do. We do. Instead of emphasizing the fact that if we do, it's by God's grace, there was a little bit of, who are these guys? Now, I want to be really clear. A few years ago at Moody Bible Institute, we had a conference which emphasized this passage, One New Man. And we had a load of speakers come in, and I think three or four spoke on this passage. And in every one of them, they talked about the alienation between Jew and Gentile, and they made it entirely the fault of the Jewish people. Oh, those Jews, you know how they are. And it really irked me. It's as if there was no Gentile condescension towards Jews. If you look at the first century world in Rome, it got so bad in Rome at one point in the first century, they kicked all the Jews out of the city of Rome. Didn't want them there. There was a great deal of anti-Semitism. In fact, the history of the church has a great deal of anti-Semitism, hatred of the Jewish people. But where did the church get it from? From the Roman world. When Christianity became the state religion of Rome, they just brought along with it that anti-Semitism that was so prevalent in Rome. So I'm not surprised that there was this attitude of, who are these guys? They have no promise to claim like we do. So that's the first problem. There was condescension. But the second part of this alienation is that the pagan situation was absolutely lost. Pagans were absolutely lost. The Gentile nations. Look at what verse 12 says. Remember that you were at that time, now I'm going to list these with you, separated from Christ, or separated from the Messiah, without Messiah. They had no messianic hope, none whatsoever. The Jewish people, it starts in the Torah, Genesis 3:15. They had the hope of the Messiah who would come and redeem them. And it comes all the way through the Hebrew Bible. In fact, that was the greatest longing of the Jewish people. What did the pagans have? No messianic hope. And then secondly, he speaks of the Gentiles. They were without status. You look at this, it says they were alienated from the commonwealth of Israel. They were foreigners. They were aliens. They had no rights to stand on. They came and what could they claim? They were alienated. And so thirdly, they were without covenants. That's what it says. They were strangers to the covenants. They had no promises to claim. Jewish people had a covenant that God made with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They could claim those covenants. They could also claim the covenant that God made with David, that he was going to send a redeemer one day to Israel. They could claim the Mosaic covenant, that if they obeyed it, God would bless them. Jewish people had covenants. What did the nations have? Nada, nothing. And then it says, because of this, they were without hope. Having no hope, verse 12 says. Having no hope. They had nothing to look forward to. Hope meaning confident expectation. There was no confident expectation. If you look at the Greek philosophy that permeated the pagan world, it was a philosophy of despair. There was no hope beyond the grave. There was no certainty. They were without hope. And then, most importantly, it says in verse 12, without God. Without God in the world. They had gods, but they didn't have God. They had statues. They had false beliefs. But Israel had the God of Israel, the true God, the one and only God. The pagans were without God in the world. Basically, they had nothing to stand on. They were in deep trouble. They were absolutely lost. Basically, what this is pointing out, and it will be pointed out again and again, that Israel needed to know God, but they were nearer because they had a good deal of revelation. But the Gentiles were far away, far, far away. Now, I do think it's interesting because Paul is basically writing to Ephesians who are Gentiles. And in the first three chapters of Ephesians, there's only one command. You read chapters 4 through 6, it's filled with command, 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 command. But there's only one command in the first 3 chapters, and it's here in verse 12 when he tells the Gentiles, remember where you came from. Remember how far you were. Remember. Boy, that's a great reminder for us. Remember where we came from. Remember that alienation. Remember what God has done by looking back and seeing how far we've come. Remember. So often we want to forget. We want to make it seem like we were all cleaned up and just great. That's why God loved us. I mean, look at us, how cool we are. What's not to love, right? But that's not how it was. What Paul is saying, remember how far God had to go to redeem you. That's a great reminder if we're ever going to experience reconciliation, because we have to remember how much we need it. We definitely need it. There was alienation between Jews and Gentiles, just like there's alienation today among peoples. And usually it comes from an attitude of superiority, which both sides had. That's what they both had. And both had nothing to stand on except for God's grace. So, starts off the problem here, alienation. Let's look at the solution. The solution that God provides is reconciliation. It starts with a statement in verse 13. The statement is this. In verse 13, I want you to look again. He's got this great contrast. But now, the Messiah Jesus has reconciled us to God. That's a full statement in verse 13. It says, but now in the Messiah Jesus, you who once were far off, that's the Gentiles, without hope in the world, have been brought near by the blood of the Messiah. But now, those who were far off, the pagans, the Gentiles who had no standing, no hope, without God in the world, they have been brought near by the death of the Messiah, by his blood, which was given for us. You can imagine people saying, huh? What? And so he has to give an explanation. Here's the explanation of reconciliation. It lays out this way. First of all, the Messiah, Jesus, personifies peace. He doesn't just provide it, he personifies it. Look at verse 14. It says, for he himself is our peace. He and no other. It's emphatic. He alone is our peace. He's not just a teacher of peace. He doesn't go around and make everyone feel better. Oh, come on, guys. Can't we all just get along? No, no, no. In his very being, he is the peacemaker. In who he is, God in the flesh, he is our peace. He is our source of peace. There is no peace any other way. He alone and no other. We can't legislate it, though we should try. We can't just all hold hands and make it happen. We need to know him, because he himself alone is our peace. He personifies the peace that we need. He also produces peace. He's the one that can produce it. He starts with a picture here in verse, always got to tell you which verse. It says in verse 14, who has made both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall. The picture he gives is that of a dividing wall. There was a dividing wall between Jews and Gentiles. Now, he's just alluding to something that everyone was aware of. What he's alluding to is that on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, there was signs between the court of the Gentiles and the more restricted holy place. The court of the Gentiles is where everyone could go, even Gentiles. But you can't cross this line. And there was a big sign, and we've recovered, I think, 4 of these from the Temple Mount. It says, Let no man of any other nation come within the fence and barrier around the holy place. Whosoever will be caught will be responsible that his own death ensues. That was they had those posted, like, you know, caution, don't come here. You're a Gentile, you could die. You step past this line. That was the dividing wall between Jews and Gentiles on the Temple Mount. Now, I don't think that's exactly what Paul is talking about, but it's something that's in the minds of people. He's alluding to that. And the reason is that, I don't know if you remember when Paul was arrested in Jerusalem, it was because they accused him of bringing Trophimus, a Gentile, past that line. And that's how he got arrested in the book of Acts. And Trophimus, anyone know what the rest of Trophimus's name is? Trophimus the Ephesian. Trophimus from their church got Paul arrested, even though Paul didn't do it. That was the allegation, that Paul had taken Trophimus the Ephesian and brought him over that line. And next thing you know, he's in Roman custody, ends up having to go to Rome. Now, I don't think he wrote this prison epistle during that imprisonment, but they're all aware of Paul's imprisonment, his first imprisonment, being caused by that allegation of him breaking that wall, breaking through with Trophimus the Ephesian. But really what he's talking about is that there is a spiritual wall between Jews and Gentiles. The law demanded separation. Keep the uncircumcised away from worship. The law is the thing that mandated that uncircumcised men, Gentiles, could not go past the court of the Gentiles. It was the law of Moses. It was God's word that decreed that. That was the dividing wall. The law of Moses, which is good and holy and just. It's a good thing, but that's where it divided. By the way, there are divisions among Jews too. If you were a priest, you could go far, but you couldn't go into the Holy of Holies. That was only for the high priest, right? So there are these narrowing of who could go where on the Temple Mount, but it was the law of Moses that mandated that. So the process that the Lord Jesus uses to resolve this is rendering the law inoperative through the Messiah's death. It says, he broke down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing, that's what this version says, the ESV, the law of commandments expressed in ordinances. The process he uses is that through his death, this version says he abolished, but I think that's a bad translation. I think it means rendering inoperative. Everyone, look at your Bible. What's the first five books in it? Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, right? That's the law. It has not been abolished. It's in there, isn't it? You still have it, I hope. You still read it? Still the word of God? I think abolished is a wrong word. But as a system, as a constitution, it is inoperative. It has been rendered inoperative. Sort of like DOS. Remember computers? Those floppy disks, the disk operating system. You know, it still exists, but it has been rendered inoperative. You look at my computer, Windows 10, right? It was rendered inoperative. Anyone here still using DOS? You could if you wanted to. There's one guy right here. What's your last name, Dinosaur? No, is it? Okay. See, it's been rendered inoperative. You could use it, but there's something that has made it better, Windows 10. That's what this is talking about, that we are not lawless. We have what Paul calls the law of Christ, the law of Messiah, the Messianic Torah. That's what we live by. But the constitution for Israel is not what the constitution for believers today in the body of the Messiah in the church. No. We are operating under the law of Messiah, not the law of Moses. I want to make three quick applications about this. This is really important for us to know. First of all, followers of Jesus are not required to keep the details of the law of Moses. That's why you're going to have Bacon Fest. And all those people who call me and say, why don't we keep Sabbath? You know? Because we're not operating under that system anymore. It's there. Secondly, here's a second application that's really important for us, is that followers of Jesus are free to keep the Mosaic Torah. You know, my professor at Moody Bible Institute, who I succeeded as professor of Jewish studies, Lewis Goldberg, I bet you can tell what his ethnicity was. I spoke with him. I used to go with him to speak and saw him speak many times at churches. And they would often have a dinner, and they'd just to honor him, because he was such a great scholar and a great man. And they would always have this ham dinner. Lou Goldberg, he would pick at it, he would slice it, but he never put a bite of it in his mouth. Not because he thought that he couldn't, but he just wouldn't. He never wanted anyone to say that this Jewish man became a believer in Jesus so he could eat pork. No, I'm never going to do that. But not because he couldn't, he just wouldn't. And he was completely right. He could do that if he wanted to. When I started a congregation, that met on Saturdays because it was designed to hopefully reach Jewish people, kept Sabbath. And there was a big church that made it seem like we were going back to the law. No, we were free to do that if we wanted to, just like Harvest for many years had a Saturday night service, right? They didn't like that either, that big church. But anyway, it doesn't matter. The point is, we're free to keep it if we want. And then thirdly, and this is really what I want us to know, followers of Jesus need to get the wisdom of the Torah. The wisdom of the Torah is great. That's why we have to keep reading. It reveals the holiness of God. The wisdom of the Torah also gives us great principles to live by, like Sabbath, for example. Now that we're free, does that mean we have to work 7 days a week? No, there's a principle there. Take one day a week for spiritual rejuvenation, spiritual revival, renewal, and physical rest. Now, in the law of Messiah, it could be any day of the week. One man honors one day above another. Another views them all alike. But still, we can get the wisdom of a day off. So we can't throw that out. It's still God's word to us. So followers of Jesus must learn from the Mosaic law. Okay, so that's how he did it. Why? Because the law of Moses was the great barrier. So the Lord Jesus dies, and that renders inoperative the law of Moses. And what does this do? The Messiah, Jesus, proclaims peace. Look at verse 15. It says in verse 15, that he might create in himself one new man in place of two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. He proclaims peace between Jews and Gentiles. That's the one new man. There is complete unity in the Messiah's body. Whether you're Jewish or Gentile, the one new man says, this is the way we can have peace. Whether we're black or white, British or French, okay, even them. No, everyone, male or female, we have been put into one new man. It's not like what God did that he said, okay, I'm going to take you and take the Gentiles and make them part of Israel. No. He's created something entirely new. The one new man, the body of the Messiah. Isn't that cool? One new man. That we can actually love and care for each other, whatever our backgrounds. That we have complete equality with each other, which is what he's going to emphasize in chapter 3, between Jew and Gentile, now in the one new man, complete equality. I went to Europe with a really good friend of mine. You may have heard of him, Erwin Lutzer. We led a tour. How many have heard of Erwin? Pastor Lutzer. Okay. Pastor Lutzer and I have become friends, and he's one of the most wise, terrific people I know. And we went to Nuremberg, where Hitler held his rallies, where they had these massive rallies celebrating Nazism, and where they had the Nuremberg laws against the Jewish people established in 1935. You know, Erwin has an uncle, had an uncle, who was an SS officer, a Nazi. My parents both survived concentration camp, but I had four brothers, half-brothers, and a half-sister who perished at Auschwitz. My dad's first wife and his children all died. His parents and his grandparents all perished in concentration camps. My mom's parents and grandparents died in concentration camp. She survived Gross Rosen. Lutzer and Rydelnik should not be friends. There we were in Nuremberg, and I hadn't even thought of this. But, you know, Pastor Lutzer, sometimes his depth perception is not great, and it's a very steep walk down those steps. Our whole group had gotten to the bottom, and I was walking down with Pastor Lutzer, and I grabbed a hold of his arm because I hated the idea of him tumbling down in front of all those people. You know, how did he die? Well, Rydelnik didn't hold his arm, so... So we're walking down, and we're about halfway down, and all of a sudden he stops, and he says, "The German and the Jew, one in Christ." That's what he said. I actually thought that was kind of corny. I was like, "Oh, Erwin, please." But he was not corny. He was right. There is no human reason that Erwin Lutzer and I should love each other. But it's because of one man that we do, the God-man, the Lord Jesus, who has knit us together and united us in him. Only he could do it. Only he could do it. That's the point of this passage. That's what he's saying. We are now one new man. And here's the great thing. Even though we're one new man, there still can be cultural diversity. We can still be different. The body of believers is not monocultural. Just remind you, how will we be worshiping according to Revelation 7? Not with one voice, but a harmony, a great symphony, every tribe and tongue and nation. Unity does not mean uniformity. Diversity does not mean division. We should not stop being who we are, but learn to accept, even enjoy, the cultural differences of all the different nations. Do you know why we should learn to enjoy it? Because our God enjoys it. He celebrates it. He wants his people to be one and create this great symphony of voices. That's what he wants. That's what he desires. Listen to what John Stott said. This new unity does more than span the Jew-Gentile divide. In other passages like Colossians 3:11 and Galatians 3:28, Paul says that it does away with sexual and social distinctions. Not that the facts of human differentiation are removed. Men remain men. And women, women. Jews remain Jews, and Gentiles, Gentiles. In fact, every group remains as they are, culturally and ethnically, but inequality before God is abolished. There is now a new unity in Christ. That's what this is about. He goes on to say that this reconciliation that he proclaims can happen because it is between God and sinful humanity. It creates equal access to God. Look at verse 16. He died so that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and he preached peace to those of you who were far away, far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. Here's what this passage is saying, that you have these two groups. You've got Jews over here, here's God. They're still distant from him, but they have the Bible. They have the promises. They have the hope of Messiah. They have it all here, but they're still alienated from God. And over here, way, way, way over here, far off, Gentiles. Nothing, absolutely hopeless. No promises, no Bible, worshiping false gods, despairing philosophies. They're way over here. And Jesus comes, and he dies for our sins and is raised from the dead. And he does this so that Jewish people can now actually enter into a forgiven relationship with God. And Gentiles, way over there, same way. They don't have to convert to Judaism. They don't have to become part of Israel. All they have to do is believe in Jesus, that he died for them and rose again. And they also can know God. And that's why what Paul says here is that they have equal access to God. They are now one in this body. That's why he came and preached peace to you who are far off and peace to those who are near. Peace with God, not with each other. First and foremost, peace with God. For through him, the Lord Jesus, we both have access in one spirit to the Father. The word there, we have access, it was used of a port where all the ships would have to come in, no matter size or distinctions. They all had to come in that one way. That's how it was used in the papyri. Equal access. We all come the same way, always through Jesus. And that reconciles us to God, and because of that, we can be reconciled to each other. We don't have to bear all the bitterness. We don't have to hold it in. We don't have to, in the sense of, oh, I am just going to hold a grudge against you because of what you did to my people. Instead, what we can do is we can love each other. We don't have to be resentful. I experienced this. I happened to have the great privilege of preaching once in the largest, well, I preached there four times, but the first time, I preached there at the largest church in New York City. It's about 99% African American. It's a fantastic church. And I was there three services for Good Friday. That's where I was preaching. And everywhere I went, and I didn't understand this, there were these two very large, tall African American men with things in their ears listening, and they were following me all over. Like between services, when I went to the restroom, I go in the restroom, and while I'm standing doing what you know I'm doing in the restroom, they come and stand next to me, each one next to me, looking out. Everywhere I went, I thought they thought I might be trying to steal the offering plates. I don't know. And afterwards, I asked the pastor, who are these guys? Here's what he said. He said, well, there's this certain sect that has made threats against me, the pastor, he said. They've made threats against me. And he said, they've even shot bullets into my front window of my home. And they really hate Jews. That's why I invited you to speak. But you don't have to worry. I didn't want to scare you, so I didn't tell you. But we had every angle covered. And I don't know if you noticed, those guys were with you on the platform too. They were going to take a bullet for you. I had never met those guys before. These black brothers who showed their great love for me, because greater love has no man than to be willing to give his life. They loved me. That's the unity that we have in Jesus. That is the greatest unity. It's the only place where we can have it is in the body of Christ. I think completely. We must have it. We have failed at it, but we must work at it. Because Jesus died for all people so that he could reconcile us to him. He died and rose again, reconciling us to him, so we can be brothers and sisters and reconciled to each other, whatever our backgrounds. That's what I learned. Well, I've got to finish. I'm way over. So let me just give you the result. The result of what Jesus has done is unification. Look at Ephesians 2:19 through 22. It says, verse 19, so then, you are no longer strangers and aliens. No longer strangers and aliens, but fellow citizens with the saints. What God did is he made us united. He united us in his kingdom. We are united in God's kingdom. Not in Israel. I think a lot of people make a mistake. They say, oh, what God did is he said, I'm going to take the Gentiles, I'll put them in Israel. No, he created a new citizenship, the church, the body. We are united in his kingdom today. That's what he's done. We're fellow citizens. There's no one that is an illegal alien anymore in the body. We're united with him. We're fellow citizens, completely equal in the community of faith. We're also united in God's household, united in his family. Look at verse, I have to get those other glasses here. It says in verse 20, verse 19, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. That's family terms. Those are the terms of being in the family together. We are members of the household of God. We are one spiritual family. Oh, don't rush me yet. I got about two more minutes. One spiritual family. We can all eat at the same table. You know, that was a problem in the first century. Jews wouldn't eat at the same table with Gentiles. Now we're all in the family. We all eat around the same table. I used to lead a messianic congregation, a congregation of Jews and non-Jews together who worshiped Jesus, the Messiah of Israel. And my associate pastor was Gentile. He was an Italian guy. And a girl in our congregation wrote a song called We're One Family. And every time we would sing at a congregation, my friend Rob would come running up to me and grab a hold of my hand and start swaying because he knew how much I hated it. To this day, Rob and I love each other. Because, even though I don't like that kind of stuff, it really is true. We're the same family. We're all in the same family of God. And then thirdly, we're united in God's temple. Remember the background. The Ephesians had the temple of Artemis. The Jews had the temple in Jerusalem. And here he says, being built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. The apostles and prophets. That's the foundation, the New Testament scriptures. Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone. The Lord Jesus is the one that holds it all together. Like playing Jenga. The one piece that holds everything together. You pull him out, it all falls. In which the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple. In him, you are being built together into a dwelling place of God by the Spirit. So the foundation are the apostles and prophets of this temple. The cornerstone is the Lord Jesus. The blocks, you and me, regardless of our ethnic backgrounds. Regardless of ethnicity or tribe or tongue or anything, we're all the blocks together, and the cement that holds it all together What is it? The Holy Spirit. A dwelling place for God by His Spirit. That's how we have unity. That's the outcome. Let me give you the bottom line on this passage, because I do have to go. You can start now. The bottom line is that God reconciled Jews and Gentiles to Himself so that Jews and Gentiles might be reconciled to each other. But what this passage is speaking broader, God reconciled people of every nation to Himself so that people of every nation might be reconciled to each other. There's no distinction in membership or ministry opportunities in the congregation. There's no distinction in staff positions. Everyone is equal. No distinction in concern or care for each other. Everyone is equal. I love, every year, I listen to the I Have a Dream speech on MLK Day. I just love that. It's the most moving speech I can think of. And I listen to it every year. I share the dream. I long for it. But apart from divine intervention, it can't come true. It's why we proclaim the good news that the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of humanity is only possible through the saviorhood of Jesus the Messiah. That's our message for us, and it's our message for the world. Let's pray. God, our Father, thank You for Your word. I love it so much because it's shown me how we can love each other. Oh God, make us the people, make this community, make each and every one of us those who love everyone, care for everyone, celebrate every distinction, and yet be unified. Oh God, bring us together so we can reflect what You have done through our Lord Jesus. And we give You praise because of the Lord Jesus, and we praise the Lord Jesus. It's in His name we pray. Amen.
Dr. Rydelnik. Good morning, Harvest. My name is Brian Laird. I serve here as the chairman of the Elder Board. And with me today is my good friend and co-laborer in Christ, Roger McCoy, who serves as our lead operations pastor.
Thank you, Brian, and good morning, church family.
If you want to take a seat, this will only take a couple minutes. Harvest family, today is the day that we have been praying and fasting for. In fact, on April 14th, when the elders called the church to prayer and fasting, God moved and answered our prayers in an amazing way. So today is an exciting day for our church.
That's right, Brian. With thanks and praise to our great Lord, I'm very excited to say that today the Harvest family gets to hear that we have selected our new lead teaching pastor. Come on.
That's right.
Come on.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. So quickly, before you get to actually hear from him, we the elders just wanted to express that this search process has been about our dependence and our trust in the Lord. And through that, we have seen the Lord confirm our pillar of prayer. We believe firmly in the power of prayer and our God who answers our prayers. We are also thankful for the many men who have served in this pulpit over the last couple of years. Men like Dave Stone, Pastor Tommy, Pastor Jeff, Pastor Eddie Hoagland, Dr. V, and our own Dr. Rydelnik, who was just up here.
Yes.
And there's so many others. And through their faithful service to the Lord and his word, our God has actually given us a great gift because he has shown us that it is he who sustains his church. Preaching God's word faithfully, which is also one of our pillars, is what he is concerned with.
Amen. Amen. I also would like to share with you that both the selection committee and the lay elders were unanimous in their decision to call this man to come lead our church. But that's enough from us. If you'll turn your attention to the screen, you will meet our new lead teaching pastor, Dr. Jeff Bucknam, and his wife, Jeannie.
Hi, my name is Jeff Bucknam, and this is my wife, Jeannie, and we are thrilled to say that we are going to be the next, I'm going to be the next lead teaching pastor at Harvest Bible Chapel. I'm super excited to come there because of the challenge that it is, to be honest with you, and the potential and how amazing it has been in the past, and my desire actually to train leaders and to see churches planted and that kind of thing is exactly what Harvest has been about for so many years. It's very much what I'm about. It's what I've been about for a lot of years in the ministries that I've been doing, and so we're just super, super thrilled that we were chosen to do this, to be honest with you. We're really blessed by it. We've had a very interesting last number of months as I've been in a conversation with the search committee and the elders and that. We made one clandestine trip to Chicago, and it was fantastic. And so we're at a point now we're really excited that we get to be a part of the ministry there. God really has moved in our lives to bring us to this point, and it's been kind of hard, but kind of great. Why has it been kind of hard, though?
It's just been a process. We have three kids that are, our oldest son is 20, our second son, Micah, is 17, and our daughter is 11. So it's just a stage of life, I think, that is hard to consider making a transition. Our boys are at a stage where they have had to consider whether they're coming with us, whether they wouldn't be coming with us, and that's been a challenge for me. But God has been moving in our hearts, I think, just warming our hearts to the idea, warming their hearts to the idea of being willing to serve him wherever he calls. And that's been a really, actually, beautiful journey for my family, for our kids, just to think about what discipleship looks like and following whatever God calls us to do. So, yeah.
We had gotten to the point, actually, that if Harvest had said no to us, we would have been heartbroken, to be honest. So we're really, really excited about it. We've been here. Right now we're in just outside of Vancouver, British Columbia. We've been here for the last 15 years. Prior to that, we were in New Zealand for 7. And prior to that, we lived in the United States for all the rest of our days prior to that. And so we have a really weird story. Like, all of our kids are Americans. All of our kids are Canadians. And 2 of them are New Zealanders. So it's difficult to go through borders. But yeah. We just want to serve the Lord with you. We want to do the very best we can to serve you and to love you. And the pillars that the church are built upon are things that we share very much and have been committing our lives and our ministry to for all these years in the past. So, look, we're really looking forward to being a part of ministry there and seeing you in May. I'm preaching 2 times in May and then coming on staff in July. But we're really looking forward to all the great things that are to come. So thanks so much. We'll see you very, very, very soon.
Thank you.
Yeah, what an exciting day. What an exciting day. So as Pastor Jeff said, he's going to be here the last 2 Sundays in May to preach in person and then back July the 12th, when he officially starts. In the meantime, we'll keep you updated through normal communications. You can also reach out to your campus pastor or elder. And additionally, we'll be updating the website, so you'll find some really good updates soon at harvestbiblechapel.org/search.
So lastly, the elders just want to say that they're thankful for the search team and all the hard work that they put in, meeting so many candidates, narrowing it down to two, and then ultimately one. Their hard work and sacrifice is what brought us to today. But most importantly, we want to thank and praise the Lord Jesus Christ, who has been sustaining Harvest Bible Chapel. We are seeing him do a mighty work here, and we are so excited for the future. So will you join me right now as we just pray and thank the Lord? Heavenly Father, Lord, we are so thankful for you. We are so thankful for the message today from Dr. Rydelnik. Lord, we're so thankful to see baptisms in our church. And Lord, we just come before you right now, and we celebrate and we praise you for what you have been doing. Lord, we just want to first lift up Northview, Jeff's current church, Lord. They are going to be told the same thing this morning. And so, Lord, they will have, as much as we are excited, they will have sadness to miss their wonderful dear pastor. And so we just pray for them as they go through their transition time. Lord, we pray for the Bucknums as they get ready to move and find a new house and just move their lives. And Lord, we pray specifically for their children, Ethan, Micah, and Sophie, as they go through the changes they have to do. And then lastly, Lord, we lift up Harvest to you. Lord, we still have to embrace Jeff and get to know him, and that's the exciting and fun things. And so, Lord, we just pray that you continue to have your hand on us. Lord, will you just bless us? Bless us as we go forth today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. As you go out, please, and over the coming weeks, please keep Pastor Jeff and Jeannie and their family in prayer as they make a pretty big move in answer to God's calling. And remember, you are loved.